book of Galatians. We had an unforeseen visitor about 3 weeks ago in Irma. So today we're going to try to cover all, we're going to try to cover all of chapter 6 of Galatians. So in order to do that, I'm going to need your help. If you're willing to read scriptures, and I ask for a volunteer, please raise your hand. If not, I will read it.
You're on either.
So that's me. Hello?
You must be on mute. You're on mute. My head's all hooked up.
I haven't touched it. How's that?
Better.
Is that more better?
Yeah.
Here we go.
All better.
Much better.
Okay.
All better.
Want to welcome our visitors? I see some faces I haven't seen in a while. Last Sabbath, we concluded our study in Galatians chapter 5, recognizing that in order to belong to Christ Jesus, the flesh must be what?
Crucified.
And we learned that from verse 24. Paul says the same thing in Romans 8, 9 to an audience that he had never met. In verses 16 and 25 of Galatians 5, we learn that it is the Holy Spirit that enables us to experience the same victories in our lives today that Jesus experienced when he was here 2,000 years ago. In Revelation 3:20, which we touched on very briefly, we learn that it's Jesus, even though he's in heaven now, it is Jesus that takes the initiative to pursue us through the Holy Spirit. Revelation 3:20 says that he's knocking on the door of our hearts. So he takes the initiative.
Amen.
The Christian world is not taught that. The Christian world is taught that we need to take the initiative to prove to God how much we appreciate what Jesus has done for us. The moment that I do that, or believe that, or accept it, I'm into what?
Works.
Works. Works of the flesh. Old covenant. It is Jesus that takes the initiative to pursue us through the Holy Spirit. And what do? We either open up the door or we keep it shut. That's our choice. Today, we study Galatians chapter 6. And
because we're so much in grammar, is that Jesus takes the initiative and Jesus took the initiative?
How are you using T-O-O-K?
As an accomplished fact, past tense. I mean, he took, he is taking, and he takes the initiative. It's like he did it and he's doing it, but it's not like it's not already accomplished. I'm just wanting to emphasize the fact that what he's done is done.
Good point. And what is it about the Godhead that triggers this initiative?
Love.
Good. Romans 5, 6. When I was helpless and ungodly, what did the Godhead do? While I was helpless and ungodly. Does it get any worse than that? How about Romans 5, 8? While I was a sinner, what did Jesus do? Took the initiative to what? Die for me. Romans 5, 10. Well, I was his declared enemy. And he knew I was going to crucify him.
That's the antenna.
What am I doing wrong?
It's just the antenna on wireless.
Okay. So, do I continue?
Yeah.
Change pocket to this thing? So, in Romans 5:10, we're told that while we were his declared enemy, and he knew I was going to kill him, what did he do for me? So, in all of these instances, what is being brought across? The Godhead takes the initiative from the beginning, right? In fact, Revelation 13:8 says what? Before man was created, Jesus volunteered to become what? The Lamb of God crucified from the what? From the foundation of the world. All of this is expressing what? Initiative. Anticipation of all of the possible problems that can develop. Do you like that? That you're surrendering yourself to someone that has anticipated all the possibilities?
Amen.
So, do I need to come up with any clever ideas or, you know, formulas or...
No, that's impossible.
That the Godhead would accept. I mean, we obviously have a lot of ideas, don't we? I know that there are approximately 70 different Protestant churches. I'm talking about the main legal churches. That doesn't include the independent ministries. Is God a God of order or confusion?
Order.
You wouldn't think so. Because they're all preaching from this thing. So God not only took the initiative for the plan of salvation, but he took the initiative to recruit some very interesting people to record these books. And that to me is assurance that it doesn't matter how bad things get. I have to look at everyone that I come across as a potential citizen for heaven for eternity. Look at verse 1 of Galatians 1. Brethren, even if a man is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in spirit for gentleness, each one looking to yourself, lest you too be tempted. So, when we look at another human being, shouldn't we look at them as a potential, what? Lifetime, eternity, citizen for heaven. And the very fact that we become aware of this person, regardless of how bad they may be, well, who's the author of Galatians? A murderer of Christians. So who are we to condemn anyone or look down on anyone, regardless of what they have done in the past? That's the point of Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. I'm going to touch very briefly on these verses so that we can go through the entire chapter. Is it possible that if I'm surrendering myself to Christ on a daily basis, that he's going to open up opportunities for me to share with someone? Be a spiritual encouragement to someone? Is that a possibility?
Yes.
In fact, folks, what other purpose is there in life other than to share what Christ is doing in each one of us? This is very important for me because I have no need to get up in front of people and say anything. I've said it before from the pulpit, I've never volunteered to offer prayer, read scripture, teach a Sabbath school class, which is a sermon. Now that's just the way I was genetically born, okay? I didn't have nothing to do with that. So I've learned through the years that when I'm asked to do something, I know it's not coming because I'm promoting myself. So I do it. I simply do it. And I've learned something very interesting, that some of the most profound truths in the Bible were uttered by Jesus on a one-on-one audience. Just him and someone else. That really makes me feel good. Because that means that God can even use me to share with others. Let's take a look at verse 2 of Galatians 6. Bear one another's burdens and thus fulfill the law of Christ. The most profound effect that we can have on someone else's life is to identify with them. Even if it's just to offer prayer. What did Jesus do in order to save each one of us? Who would like to take a look at Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17 and 18? Hebrews chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Mary Jane?
Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For he himself has suffered, being tempted, he was able to aid those who are tempted.
Thank you. The Greek word for he had to be is obligated. Obligated. There was no option here. There was no choice here. He was obligated. Why?
So he could be a human
for salvation.
So that he could ethically and legally what? Yes? He was obligated. And since God cannot be tempted, then verse 18 suggests that he took on my nature, and it was then that Satan saw an opportunity to take control of the human race. These are profound thoughts. And as you go through your daily life, if you focus on the fact that when we talk about being crucified, that may sound like a horrible experience, physically and otherwise, especially since my flesh doesn't want to be crucified. But when we choose to be crucified with Christ, there is the good news right there. We're not doing something alone. We're doing it in Him and with Him. And it's already been done. So we're not inventing anything. We're just saying no to the sinful flesh. If we do not say no to the sinful flesh, then we're doing what Satan or Lucifer did in heaven.
What in the rebellion?
And the consequence of that is eternal death. Galatians 6, 3 and 4. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone, and not in regards to another. What does that mean? That I should not boast until I actually become something, and then it's okay for me to boast? Is that what it's saying? No. The statement is very clear. We are nothing and always will be nothing from the standpoint of us accomplishing something. In the sight of God, we are the apple of His eye. You like that?
Yeah.
Now, let's go to Scripture and see if I can support from Scripture what I just said. That even when we're at our very, 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 very best, we are nothing. Who would like to read, look up Psalms 39, verse 5. Psalms 39, verse 5. Volunteer, right here. Diana?
Indeed, you have made my days as hand breaths, and my ages as nothing before you. Certainly, every man at his best state is but a thief.
Pretty clear. The moment that we exalt ourselves, who are we imitating? Let's take a look at 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. You want to like to read that for us? Okay, how about that?
that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God.
Thank you. Pretty clear. What is the purpose of life on this earth for the Christian?
Glorify God.
Yeah. And the only way we can do that is by crucifying self. Is that not what Jesus did in order to qualify to be the Redeemer? Did he come here to show how terrific he was?
No.
Right. And several times in Scripture he tells us that he of himself could do nothing. So why would I ever think that I can do anything? Or that I'm smarter than someone else, or I can produce more works than someone else, or all these things that I'm doing is because I want to have more stars in my crown than anybody else. What kind of an attitude is that? Satanic. 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 Let's take a look at Galatians 6:5. For each one shall bear his own load. Is this a contradiction of verse 2?
No. It's a balance.
One of the subheadings for chapter 6 is to bear one another's burdens.
So, mine says bear and share the burdens.
Excellent.
And the NLT verse 5 says, for we are each responsible for our own conduct.
So bearing one another's burdens doesn't mean that we dump on someone else, does it? Okay. And yet, we have to look for opportunities where we can share and be an encouragement. Share with others. Be an encouragement to others in any way that we possibly can be. What does it mean? Well, let's take a look at Psalms 55, verse 22. Psalms 55, verse 22. This is a very important concept. Psalms 55, verse 22. Who would like to read that for us? Okay, I will read it. Say ready when you're there.
Ready.
Cast your burden upon the Lord, and He will sustain you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. He will never allow the righteous to be what? Does that mean that when you're baptized, you're no longer tempted? That's why I chose to be baptized. My understanding was that I became untouchable. I like that because I was failing in winning over my sinful nature. My sinful nature kept winning. I said, I gotta find a better way to do this thing called Christian living. So I said, hey, these people say that once I'm baptized, I'm justified. I even did something terrible. Well, I was told that it was terrible after I was baptized. The first week after I was baptized, I went to a movie. And the movie was so good that I went back a second time. And when I told my best friend, who was a Christian, what I'd done, he said, oh, do you realize what you've done? You've lost your justification. And I said, dumb me, I didn't know anything. Well, what do I do to make that right? And he gave me a series of things. And that sounded to me like what I had grown up with, Catholicism. I was not a Catholic, but I was raised by a devout Catholic grandmother. And so I said, that sounds like penance. But it can be. So I kept listening. But my Christian life was just like this. And it was crazy. So what does it mean that he will not allow us to be the righteous, to be shaken? What does that mean?
It means he will give us strength to
might be the question that I'm asked most frequently. How do I deal with this? How do I deal with that? I'm discouraged. I keep messing up in this area. I got these other things, I got these other things under control, but in this area, I just keep messing up. So, what I say is, I've never suggested anyone memorize a scripture in the Bible, but if you ever choose to memorize a scripture, I would suggest that it would be 1 Corinthians 10:13. Amen. 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has or ever will overtake you that is not known to man. Because God is faithful. And God will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able to endure. And with the temptation that God permits in your life, God will provide a way of escape so that you will be able to bear anything that Satan throws at you or that your sinful nature is tempted by. Do you like that?
Amen.
Well, Chuck, even in this psalm, there's two parts to it. There's verbs. That's cast your burden on the Lord, and He shall sustain you. If you think about abiding in the vine, the nourishment we receive from the vine, He shall sustain you. And what is the action that we have to do? We have to yield that thing to Him, cast it to Him, and then He will sustain you. And then that you get this third part, that then you won't be moved, the righteous won't be shaken. Without the first two parts, I don't think that you can get the third part.
Right. I'm just trying to keep it as simple as possible.
Oh, yeah, but that's
an excellent point.
Great verse.
That's an excellent point. The righteous will not be shaken. What is it? What is the significance of the word righteous? When do we become righteous?
We're justified. Jesus.
We become righteous when we understand the three phases of righteousness or justification. Time does not permit to go into that. But Jesus said to John the Baptist, you need to baptize me so that all what can be
righteous.
That's speaking of changing our title from one of condemnation to justification. Then, Paul writes in Romans 8:4 that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in whom? Who do not walk according to the
flesh,
but according to the
spirit.
That's the second aspect of righteousness. Okay? Two separate words. And if you don't understand what they mean, then how can you receive a blessing from it and apply it in your personal life? So the first one is the title to heaven. The second one is Christian living, driving this sinful bus. Jesus chose to let who drive his bus?
Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Then the third usage of the word righteousness is that the works that we produce, they're produced by whom?
Holy Spirit.
And that's when Revelation 19:7-8 will be fulfilled. So that's the aspect of the righteous will not be what? Shaken. Okay. Verse 6. And let the one who is taught the word share all good things with him who does the teaching. What does that mean? We need to support the ministries of the church. We need to support the ministries of the church with our tithes. Tithes belong to the organized church, not to any independent ministry. Offerings. Donations of food, clothing, encouragement of the leaders, especially the pastors. The pastors need encouragement because of their dedication and their time. The pastors need encouragement. Okay. Galatians 6:7-8. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man sows, that's what he also reaps. For the one who sows, verse 8, to his own flesh shall from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit shall from the Spirit reap eternal life. Does that mean that we have a choice as to what we sow?
Yes.
Because in the Christian world today, we're being taught that we're taught that you are doomed from the time that you're born. Does the flesh corrupt?
Yes.
Okay. Let's take a look at a scripture in the Old Testament, Jeremiah 17:5. Who would like to read that for us? Jeremiah 17:5. Volunteer? Jeremiah 17:5. Okay. Diane, please. Jeremiah 17, verse 5.
Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord.
Thank you. What does that mean to trust in man? What do we learn in Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9? Paul says, what is going on with you, Galatians? What is going on? You are listening and responding to people that are corrupting the gospel that I've taught you. Then he says, in Galatians 8 and 9, he uses a very interesting word that applies to those that are teaching these blasphemies. The word that he uses is curse. And he uses it in verse 8 and 9. I touched very briefly on that when we studied Galatians 1, 8 and 9, what the word curse means. Do you remember what the word curse means?
Anathema.
Anathema in Greek. Very good. In English, what does that mean?
Excommunicate.
Very good. Excommunicate. Ban this person that teaches something other than what God has inspired in His Word. Think about that. Some people got upset with me when I said they were preaching six different gospels in our church. That was 1989. And I brought a little book, and I asked Carl to read the title. The title of the book was, Who's Got the Truth? And it was written as a result. It was written by the associate editor of Ministry Magazine, Mark Weber. And it's a result of one-on-one interviews and over the phone with the five main proponents of these different gospels. I'm not going to go any further, because the word curse there is crucial. How many gospels did God inspire to be recorded in His Word?
One.
Let's take a look at the last part of verse 8 again. But the one who sows to the Spirit shall from the Spirit reap eternal life. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
Now, what does a shrewd general do to distort a beautiful promise like this? Who's the shrewd general here?
Satan.
Satan has convinced many that even after they have been born of the Spirit, they will never completely gain victory over the flesh. What is the biblical response to this satanic deception? Who would like to read Romans 6, 17, 18, and 19? Maybe I should read it. Romans 6, verses 17, 18, and 19. When you're there, say ready and I will read. Romans 6, 17, 18, and 19. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, and this word sin here is speaking of the condition, not the verb, you became obedient from the what?
Heart.
To that form of teaching to which you have committed yourself. And having been freed from sin, the condition, you became slaves of righteousness. 19. I am speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you